All right, guys, we've been talking out of 1 John chapter number 1. We've been talking on the issue of fellowship. I preach on fellowship in our church on Sunday as well, right out of this same passage. And that word fellowship is a Greek word, koinonia. Koinonia, and it has to do with sharing or commonality. We have something in common. Right. You have it and I have it. We have it. You have it individually. I have it individually. We have it collectively. But it is a common thing, whatever this thing is. Well, on Sunday, as I preached and I looked at this chapter, I'll just give you the outline that I gave to our church on Sunday as I taught through this. You know, in 1 John, and I hope if you got your Bibles, you're there. I'm not there. I'm somewhere over here in Colossians. But over in 1 John, chapter number 1, we see that, you know, the word fellowship is used over and over again. Again, this book is about fellowship. It's about this business of walking with the Lord, right? We have tried to take pains to tell you that the business of relationship must be established before there is fellowship. Relationship, meaning by that every person needs to have a personal relationship with God. I'm talking about a not just creator-creation relationship, but a father-son relationship. You must be born into God's family. Jesus said you must be born again. You say, why must I be born again? Because the first birth was wrong. You were born into sin. David said in Psalm 51:5, behold, I was shapen in iniquity and in sin did my mother conceive me. Right? The Bible says the wicked go estranged from the womb, right from the womb, speaking lies. It's the nature, the fallen nature. That nature that's in Adam. And so you must be born again, born spiritually. Literally, it's born from above, a birth that is outside of you, that happens inside of you. Something, a life that's given to you from above is what it's talking about. And so if you are born again, you move into a father-son relationship with God, not just creation, creator. God is everybody's God, but he's not everybody's father. The Bible says, to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons of God. To as many as received him. See? Then he says to those who received him, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the what? Children, sons of God, the children of God. But that's to those who have received Christ. And so you must receive Christ to be born again. And life comes in. The Bible makes it clear that everybody outside of Christ is dead in trespasses and in sin. 1 Corinthians 15:22 says, in Adam all die. Now, we are all in Adam. We're born in Adam. You know, I'm talking about Adam is the original federal head of the human race. And we are all born from Adam. And in Adam all die. But in Christ, Jesus is all made alive. So the question is, who are you in Adam or are you in Christ? And the Bible talks about Christ as being the last Adam. Right? He's the federal head of a new generation. Adam of the old. You must be born again. And when you're born again, you are now in relationship with God. It's a matter of the blood. God becomes your father, spiritual father. Right? You all know this, right? If you don't know this, listen in, because this is true. God becomes your father, your spiritual father. We have the wonderful privilege of calling him Father. Jesus taught us to call him Father. Father, Abba, Father. He's most Abba, Papa, Dada, the most basic syllables that a little child can lisp, can say. He's our Father. So, and that's a wonderful relationship. Now, beyond that, right beyond that, is the business of what? Fellowship. Y'all remember this, right? Right beyond relationship is fellowship. Now, as a son, while this relationship is cannot be destroyed, there's no such thing as today I'm a child of God, tomorrow I'm not. If you have that idea, you're living under the law. You're living under the, I got to perform in order to somehow stay in good graces with God to be his child. No. You're born into, you're birthed in his family, and you are the child of God. And I'm going to tell you, eternal security is a wonderful truth. I'm eternally secure. If you're not eternally secure, you're not secure at all. Friend, if you could lose it, you would have already lost it. I mean, if it was something for me to lose, I'd have lost it. So I don't get to heaven because I got a good grip and I got hold of God. I get to heaven because he's got a good grip. He's got a hold of me. The Bible says we're kept by the power of God. The God who saves you is the God who keeps you. And if that ain't the case, God help you. You follow me? I can't even find my car keys in the morning, talking about keeping my soul. But, now listen, that's the reality, that's the truth. But right next to this, hard against it, is the issue of fellowship. That is, not am I a son, but the question is, what kind of son am I? Am I a son who is enjoying the Father? Am I a son who is walking in obedience? Am I a son who's walking in holiness because the Father is holy? He said, be ye holy for I am holy. So we have to come out from among them and be what? Separate. Not just separate from the world, but separated unto God. And walk with him in fellowship. Koinonia, where I share his life, I share his love, I share all the graces that he give to me. And to be sure, walking with God is by grace, just like being born again is by grace. For by grace are ye saved. But then if, you know, every grace of life comes from him. Hey, if you are an obedient son today, thank God that he has prompted you toward that, right? If you enjoy, hey, listen, if you are obedient, if you have a desire to live for God, a desire for, you know what? That's God who did that. That's not native to you. Our sinful nature is to pull away from God. We want autonomy. So that work that wants to be, that's been done in you is what prompts obedience. Right? The Bible says it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. The very desire to do it and the dynamic to pull it off comes from God. I can do all things through who? Christ who strengthens me. And without me, you can do what? Nothing. All things through Christ. Without Christ, nothing. No thing. But when God saves us, he saved us for fellowship. This spiritual no man's land of I'm in relationship, but I'm not in fellowship. There's a dead monkey on the line somewhere. You know what I'm saying? God saved me, and that relationship is a permanent sealed one by the grace of God. But he saved me for fellowship, not to be out here freelancing. He saved me to walk with him, right, to share of his grace. And you and I, the same thing. So I outlined this chapter in chapter number one here in 1 John, how we share in a living fellowship. Everything here is about life. Look, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon with our hands looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, the life, and bear witness, what, of who? The life, and show unto you that, what, eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. So now, what do we have in common? Do we have in common just some goal? Do we have in common just some agenda? Do we share some strategy? What do we have in common? I'll tell you what we have in common. Life. It's a life that we share. You share in this life and I share in this life. It's a living thing that we share in. Not just some goal or agenda or purpose. Let's lock arms and here we go, right? We share life. And he talks about this life as being eternal life. Who is that eternal life? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ did not come into existence at conception. And he certainly didn't come into existence in Bethlehem. Jesus predates time. He is the eternal God who was born into time. He's the transcendent God above creation that moved into creation. And he is the one that we have in common, this living hope, this life. And that's the thing I want you to understand. It's like you have your life in me, I have my life in me, but and no matter, I can get up here, try to express myself. I can sing a song. You can say, well, he can sing. Some say, well, not so much. I can do poetry. I may share what I have in my heart or what's on my soul. You know, we talk about, let me just share something with you. But the truth of the matter is, my life is in me and your life is in you. But let me tell you something. Christ's life is in you and Christ's life is in me. So we share life. Remember that old soap opera? What? One life to live. There's only one life to live, and that's Christ's life. And you are living that life, and I'm living that life. The Bible says, for believers, we are crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, we live, yet not us, but who? But what? Christ lives within us. It's that one life, and we share that life. It's a living fellowship. Sometimes we say, you know, fellowship is two fellas on the same ship. Well, you know, that's cute, but let me tell you something else. It's not just two fellas on the same ship, it's two fellas sharing the same life. That's right? We're sharing this life. It's living. And it's joyous, verse number 4. He says, we share this. Hey, so you might have fellowship, and we share this, that your joy might be what? Full, because that's where joy is, in fellowship with God the Father and with God the Son. That's where joy is. That's the only place where true, genuine joy is going to be found. Joy is not found in some smoke-filled den of iniquity. Joy is not found at an amusement park. Joy is not found at a racetrack. Joy is not found on the... Now, listen to what I'm telling you. You may have joy in those places, but not found there. Joy is only native to the believer who is walking in fellowship with God. I'm not telling you you can't go somewhere and have fun. And I'm talking about this deep-seated, deep-abiding joy of the Lord that is your strength, that where though there may be bitter and warm tears that roll down your face, there is this well-being in your soul that goes beyond the situation, right? I've done it so many times, preach with tears in my eyes, a funeral or something like that, but joy in my soul because death is interrupted, but it never will have the last word. Oh, that's joy. That gives me joy. Death doesn't reign here. It's interrupted. It's caused grief to the family. Here we are. But it doesn't have the last word. Oh, that gives me joy. And this fellowship is a joyous fellowship. Joy is one of the markers of a Christian life. It is a fruit of the Spirit. Fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, joy. Right? So this fellowship that we share is living. This fellowship that we share is a joyous fellowship. It's one of the markers again. I ask this question, and I have to ask it of myself and be honest. Right now, do you have the joy of the Lord? Sometimes people say, well, you know, the devil stole my joy. You know, he can only steal it if you're careless with it. Yeah, if you're careless with it. Right? Sometimes we talk about how Jacob stole Esau's birthright. The Bible doesn't say he stole it. The Bible says Esau was a profane person. The Bible says Esau was careless. He treated lightly that which he should have treated dearly. You follow what I'm saying? And he squandered it. The devil can't steal your joy. You just treat it lightly. You treat your relationship with God lightly, and joy goes. You wonder sometimes why God's people so cotton picking mad about everything. You say, but don't you see the world around you, man? I'll tell you what, the God in Washington about to drive me crazy. Hey, listen, you don't have to go crazy because things going crazy. There's vexing things in this world, but it's always been that way. You said the world's falling apart. When has it ever been together? Come on now. We get our eyes on all this stuff, and then our joy goes out the window like God has lost an election. I don't understand it sometimes. But not just on the national scene, you know, it can happen in a family. I mean, I know we're human. Things go get cattywampus in the family, or things get, you know, or in your life or that, and joy goes somewhere. But listen, folks, joy is a birthright for the believer, and joy is an evidence that a Christian is walking in right relationship with God. I'm not telling you that there won't be sorrow, but sorrow doesn't chase joy away. Joy is an inside job, and it comes in walking in close relationship with God, in close fellowship with God. So, right now, am I experiencing the joy of the Lord? You know, I have preached a message out of Joshua where God said to Joshua, "Go into the land. Every place your feet shall trod, that have I given to you." You see that? I have given everything that you will walk on to you. I have already given. So, but here's the great thing. The promised land is our land. And I'm not talking about some geographical place on the earth. In the spiritual analogy from the Old Testament and New Testament, Christian people from the New Testament, the promised land is this place of sweet and wonderful fellowship with God, where the fruit and honey of the Spirit is. Whether you're talking about the milk and honey, a land of milk and honey, that you won't find that in some geographical spot. That's an inside job. So when we talk about in the promised land, we're not talking about pomegranates and strawberries and figs and olive trees and, right? We're talking about love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. That's the promised land. The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I am come that you might have life and have it. That's the promised land. Ephesians 1 says we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing, not geographical, not earthly, every spiritual blessing in the what? Heavenly realm. So just like Israel had to go in and possess their promised land, so we as Christians have to go in and possess our promised land. And everything over there is ours. And so the question is, am I possessing my possession? You know what I'm saying? It's mine, but is it really mine? How many of y'all got books y'all hadn't read? The book is yours, but it ain't yours because you ain't read it. You follow what I'm saying? I mean, I got stuff in my shelf I can't even reach. You know what I'm saying? So, like, the same thing is true in the spiritual. It's ours. But am I possessing my possession? So my thing is like, is joy yours? Yes. Do you possess it? Is peace yours? Yes. Do you possess it? Is contentment yours? Yes. Do you possess it? And that comes in this, what I call precarious thing called fellowship. When I say precarious, in that it can be easily broken down. Not relationship, fellowship. My relationship, I would say, is indestructible. Faith, fellowship is fickle. Can two walk together in fellowship and they what? Without what? Agreeing. So to whatever point I'm walking with God and I fail to agree with God, fellowship gets broken. And it's only until I agree with God, that's what the word confession means, by the way. Homologeo means to confess, to say the same thing God says. That means I bring my heart and my life in agreement with God. Because when I'm walking with God, God's never wrong. I'm the one that's wrong. So in word, thought, and deed, where I fail to disagree, when I fail to agree with God and his holy nature, fail to agree with God and his will for my life, when I fail to agree, that's where fellowship starts. And that's where there's a sense of a loss of joy. And all of these things start to flood in. It's a joyous fellowship, and God intends for it. And listen, this is a marker. For me, for you, do I have the joy of the Lord? But it is a truthful fellowship and an honest fellowship, because the Bible talks about in verse number 5, this then is the message which we've heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. You know what that's alluding to? See, look, the rest of this chapter deals with either darkness or light. Truth or a lie? Everything else. Right? How can you say, I'm having fellowship with God and you walking in darkness? Because God is light and in him there is no what? Darkness at all. You said I'm walking with God, light, God, and you walking in darkness, you lie. And the truth is not in you. You see, the whole idea is fellowship that we share. The fellowship we share is a living fellowship. It's to be a joyous fellowship, but it's to be an open and an honest fellowship so that we really share life, and it's about truth, it's about honesty, it's about openness. Transparency. It is, here's the thing. We can come here, guys, listen, and I can't. Only Jesus can get out the spots and the wrinkles. Right? So I don't want to come here and like try to be picking ticks off you all day, right? And you pick it and you beholding the speck in my eye, and we're looking at each other doing it. But there is a place for this introspection in our own life by the word of God. There is this place of discernment and a place of accountability in each other's lives where we do walk as God has commanded us to walk. So we can come and sing, we are band of brothers, right? Are we really a band of brothers? I mean, is there really fellowship? You know what I'm saying? We can go to church and sing, we are one in the spirit, we are one, right? We can sing all those things, and yes, that's truth, that's ours, but is it really ours? And so the fellowship here is about, you know, like if I'm in the light, if he's in the light, then his blood cleanses me. And we have fellowship one with another, one another, one another, one another, one another. Openness and honesty with one another, openness and honesty with God. Openness and honesty. So here's the thing that I, I do. I notice. I mean, we do it. I just want the Holy Spirit of God. I say this because sometimes if you don't have the Holy Spirit of God is to bring to your remembrance, right, things. So you can't remember nothing you never learned. So I feel responsible to say this so that the Holy Spirit got something to bring to your remembrance, okay? We can come to a place like this, the lights are on, here we are, and pretend to be in fellowship. Then we break off in our little groups of people who are more like us, and then we really are honest. You follow what I'm saying? We really are open to the people who look like us, think like us, come from where we come, have the same worldview that we have. That's where we really are honesty. And it's not honesty around the person of God. It is more like our, as I said, our little cultural cult. Right? So, fellowship transcends politics, race, denomination. I'm not telling you it transcends truth. It doesn't. We see, if truth is central, because that's who Jesus is, if truth is central, if we would be willing by the grace of God to say, Lord, I want truth in my life. You want truth. Thou desires truth in the inward part. I know this is what God wants. I want to live in truthfulness. I'm telling you, a lot of our angst would go away, certainly in the church. Then we would be effective witnesses for the world. But the church don't have its act together because we are more interested in something other than truthfulness and honesty. And I'm talking about truth and honesty with ourselves primarily. I mean, we get with our group. We know what's true and honest about them. We can point it out. But you know what? It really takes courage. I'm finding this out. It really takes courage not to speak. You know, I could go to a hall of people who believe everything just like me. And boy, there's a big rally. Everybody is euphoric. It takes courage to speak to people, right, in my own group about what God says. Don't take me much to get out there and talk about what's wrong with them. I mean, I could work you into a lather. Talk about what's wrong with some folk. Right? But it is honesty right here. And let's deal with the junk. Deal with the junk. Not be afraid to engage and talk to people who are different from me, but we're here and we're saying, we're united, we're one in the Lord. Are we really? What am I walking in? What am I holding on to that comes from the life of darkness? A friend of mine was telling me at a church I preached to not long ago, we were talking on the phone. He said, hey man, let me tell you something that happened about the sermon you preached. I preached a sermon on out of Revelation chapter number 2, verses 18 and following, to the church of Thyatira. And there was a person in there that the Bible calls a Jezebel. And she enticing my people, seducing my people to commit adultery, fornication. But really in that, and it may have been actual adultery, but fornication and adultery is always a picture of spiritual unfaithfulness. And so, but I was teaching on that. He said, well, let me tell you what happened. He says he and his wife went out to a place to eat brunch after the service, and a lady was in there, and she was at the eating too, and she recognized him as the pastor of the church, And he didn't know her, but she knew him. And what has happened is she's been coming and she's been in their overflow room. It's a sizable church, but there's a group of people in the overflow room. And he said, she was talking about how the sermon really impacted her, the sermon I preached. And the woman went on and says, I'm afraid I'm that Jezebel. You know, because there's talked about Jezebel in that church. Say, I believe I'm a Jezebel. Talked about who she was, how old she was, and what she'd been, you know, kind of like living like a cougar. You know? And she went on and on and on talking about just not being right with God and that. And when he finished telling me, we both agreed, don't you love people like that? You say, what? Love people like that? Here's a woman who's talking to the preacher quite openly and honestly about her life, how she's not right with God. I mean, I talk to people sometimes like who just open and honest preacher. I'm just tell you right now, I want God to help me, but I struggle with a lot of what I see. I'm struggling some stuff in my life, you know. I had a man in this place right here came and told me, kissed me on my cheek one time, said, man, I used to think black people was the scourge of the earth. He used to think that, see. I love openness and honesty. I'd 100 times rather that than people pretending, got on all the glad rags, looking like this or that, and shake your hand, smile in your face, and then go off and get in the little corner. You'll never have fellowship like that. You're only going to have fellowship when you talk about your struggles and know yourself, and here's where I'm struggling, where you're struggling, let's be a blessing to each other. And then guess what? Some of this stuff about our ethnicity begin to fade away. Financial strata fades away. You know why? Because we are fellowshipping. We are enjoying this oneness that we have in Christ. That's the only way it can happen. That's the only way it can happen. Openness, honesty, truthfulness. And when I'm open and when I'm honest and when I'm truthful, you will see I am a flawed man saved by the grace of God. Oh, no. You already see. I will see I am a flawed man saved by the grace of God. And let me tell you something about flawed men who understand they're flawed men who are saved by the grace of God. They are not judgmental men. Because I know every man I'm laying my eyes on right now is a struggler. You follow what I'm saying? And everybody got their issues. And you know what that means? Issue. Right? We all have it. And yours may not be mine. And so that's what I was saying the other week when I was saying, you know, the guy who is the adulterer, say, not them homosexuals, boy, they need to get right with God. You see what I'm saying? So says the adulterer. I'm just saying everybody has their own particular spiritual self-righteous thing that they could hold on to. You messed up pointing a finger at somebody else. Follow me? The racist says, I can't believe the abortionist. The abortionist can't believe the person who's a racist. You know what I'm saying? We're all messed up. Amen. And we need the grace of God. And not act like we got some spiritual high ground that keeps us from even talking to people who would do that. I can't believe they would do that. I can't believe. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Do I know how a person can be an adulterer? I do. Do I excuse it? No, we have to repent of it. Do I understand how a person can have homosexual tendencies? I do. Because the devil don't care how you get screwed up, long as you screwed up. Right? And people who die and go to hell, the devil doesn't say, well, I'm looking for only homosexuals. Or I'm looking for only racists today. He don't care how you come to hell, long as you come. I'm serious. He don't care. Come with your education. Come with your accomplishments. Or come with your white collar. Or come with no collar. Just come. You know what I'm talking about? Just come on to hell. He don't care how you're wrong with God and not walk in fellowship. Walk, long as the fellowship. Hey, you racist? Check. Homosexual? Check. Follow me? You adulterer? Check. You corporate embezzler? Check. You slumlord? Check. Who I ain't got yet? You drunkard? Check. He don't care. Hey, the devil don't care how you get all messed up. And here we are pointing fingers. Right? We need to repent. And agree with God. Be open and honest with God, and be open and honest with you, and be open and honest with myself. If you say, I have no sin, you are delusional. The Bible says you make God a liar, verse number 10. You make God a liar. You're saying, God, you're lying. I have no sin. That's a delusional person. I call it denial. D-E-N-I-A-L. Don't even notice I'm lying. People who are in denial don't even know. They just go through life living the lie. Oh, God, help me not to live the lie. Help me not to live the lie. Keep me back from these presumptuous sins. So, fellowship is to be open and it is to be honest. And what I'm saying and what I said to church Sunday, and it's true, that while we all have privacy, there ought not be secrecy. Y'all hear what I'm saying? The Christian life, I mean, we can have privacy. Right? You come to my house, you don't have a right to read my mail. You know, make yourself at home don't mean you open my mail. So in my home, I got things that are private, but in my home, I don't have things that are secret. Shouldn't anyway. Right? I ain't got some torture chamber downstairs in the cellar. That I don't want nobody moonshine still in the barn. I ain't trying to keep no secrets. Yes, in the fridge. You know, you don't have to cook it no more, man. Just go buy it. But you see what I'm saying? Like, if there's an openness and an honesty, we're honest with God, honest with ourselves, honest with one another, then that fellowship is wonderful, is sweet. It's real, first of all. So, we're supposed to get in chapter number 2. We'll do that next week. So, hey guys, fellowship is what? Koinonia, sharing, a commonality, to communicate, to contribute, to participate, to partake in. It's a partnership. And that only happens, you know, like we're united around life, the life I have in me, the life you have in me, in you. It's not, you know, we meet on Tuesday mornings at 6:30, you know, like we loosely connected people who happen to be in the same place at 6:30 on Tuesday mornings. It's not fellowship. Fellowship is an understanding of we share the same life. We share the same life, and I'm black and you're white and you're rich and I'm poor and you're educated and I'm uneducated and you this and I'm that, not all of that life. We share the same life. And then the joy from that life in me, the joy in that life in you, and joy plus joy is a multiplied joy. You know, all the graces of God, when I share what I have with you, you share what you have with me. When you share the things that God gives you, you don't have less of them, you have more of them. I'm talking about the real riches. Share joy, you don't have less joy. I gave half my joy away. No. You multiply joy when you share. Not divide it, not subtract it. That's how it works with the stuff that money can't buy. And then it's open and not, it's honest, it's real. So I don't have to talk in hushed tones about a group of people over here. Yeah, they did, they that, they that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. We right. Openness and honesty means I'm going to know who this man is. I want to know who you are. I want to know who you are. And I want you to know who I am. And because we share the same life, we have fellowship with one another. Not, well, hey, let's go on and pray. We'll be close. Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for your goodness, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And Lord, I pray that you would, by your Spirit, do what I could not in another 3 days talking to these men. I cannot possibly do it. And so take my, Lord, rambling thoughts and all of this today and do that deep and abiding work that only you can do in our hearts anyway. We ask it now. We know we need it. We know in our heart of hearts we need it. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.